Good evening. It is my pleasure to welcome each of you to Benton Chapel this evening for the 42nd Annual Antoinette Brown Lecture. My name is Sherry Brewer, and I'm a third-year Divinity student serving on the lecture committee. Tonight is a really special occasion for the Vanderbilt Divinity community. We podium. And we also kick off a celebration of the 20th anniversary of the Carpenter Program in Religion, Gender, and Sexuality, for which Dr. Levine served as the first director 20 years ago. So it is a great evening of learning, reflecting, and celebrating. The evening is only possible because of the work of many people, so we want to acknowledge a few of those folks. There are many. First of all, to Dean Towns, for your guidance and support throughout the lectureship, to Ellen Armour, if you would, there you go, who holds the E. Rhodes and Leona B. Carpenter Chair of Feminist Theology and also directs the Carpenter Program, to the visionary and tireless staff of the Carpenter Program, Lindsay Godwin, where's Lindsay? She's up at the top, okay, Assistant Director, and Carlin Rushing. And the amazing Shatika Brown, who asked me not to call out her name, but if you know Shatika, she's in charge of so many things that work out well here. And last but not least, I wanted to thank the other students on the serving on the committee. And if you would stand, co-chair Sarah Smith, Judith Claire June, and Anita Peoples, thank you for all your hard work that's made this possible. So under this soaring ceiling, among all these learned folks, it may be easy for words like ivory tower to enter our minds tonight, but I want to suggest that that's not really what this lecture is about. It's about religious scholarship that connects to the everyday lives of real women in all walks of life. Because, as I learned recently, this lecture was born out of protest. And let me explain. A few weeks ago, I had a conversation with Sylvia Sanders Kelly, who is a person who alum of Vanderbilt University and founded the lectureship and funds it. She regretted that she couldn't be here tonight, but she asked if I would tell you a story and also issue you a challenge. So the story is this. In the 1970s, Mrs. Kelly was very involved in the struggle for the passage of the Equal Rights Amendment, which often led her to the capital of Georgia in Atlanta, where she lives. And over there, she came face to face with opponents of the ERA, and often they held placards with Bible verses. Their understanding of faith took them in one direction and hers took her in another. Well, we know how this story turned out. We were three votes short of passing, changing the Constitution, 35 states ratified. In Georgia, her own Georgia was never, always voted it down when it came up for vote. But she recognized in that loss that biblical interpretation was a crucial part of the loss, and religious teaching could either limit or liberate. She wanted more liberation. And this lecture is a result of, a partial result of what she learned in that process. So that's the story, and here's her challenge. Of course, in 2016, this work is far from done. Pick up a newspaper or open your social media, and you will see stories about street harassment, persistent wage gap, legislative obstacles to women's health care, violence against trans women. The struggle is as relevant and urgent today as it was then, even more so as we acknowledge how intersecting oppressions like racism, homophobia, transphobia, and classism compound the struggle. Liberation is a long game. Fortunately, we in the church are up to this task. Womanist theologians remind us that our religious heritage is all about making a way out of no way. Theology was never and is not now and never will be an esoteric matter confined to these beautiful walls because it deeply shapes our everyday realities and alters the horizon out in front of us. So with this past as well as with our future challenge, we are honored by your presence here tonight as we learn and celebrate and look forward to building
Good evening. It is good to have you here, and let me add my own welcome to this gathering and to say how pleased I am to be introducing one of my cherished colleagues, Professor Amy Jill Levine. But first, let me tell you a little bit about Antoinette Louisa Brown Blackwell so that you have some sense of who it is that we celebrate also tonight. She was born in Henrietta, New York on May 20th, 1825, and began to speak publicly in the services of the local congregation church at the age of 9. She kept at it, and her last sermon was preached at the age of 90, and her last book appeared when she was 93. She died in Elizabeth, New Jersey on November 5th, 1921 at the age of 96. This lectureship celebrates her long career, as well as the Oberlin roots of the Divinity School, and we're pleased to offer this lectureship in her honor. This year's lecturer is Professor Amy Jill Levine, who is the University Professor of New Testament and Jewish Studies and the E. Rhodes and Leona B. Carpenter Professor of New Testament Studies and Professor of Jewish Studies at Vanderbilt University Divinity School and the College of Arts and Science. She is also affiliated professor with the Center for the Study of Jewish Christian Relations in Cambridge, UK. Stop it. As you can tell, this goes on sometimes. She wrote a lot of books. She gives a lot of talks. And she is a self-described Yankee Jewish feminist, a member of Congregation Shereth Israel, an Orthodox synagogue in Nashville, although she is quite unorthodox. This, I think, is a huge understatement. Please join me in welcoming Professor A.J. Levine as this year's Antoinette Brown Lecturer as we celebrate the 20th anniversary of the Carpenter Program and AJ's crucial role as its founding director. The title of her lecture is The Carpenter, Gender and Sexuality, The Use and Abuse of the Gospels in Politics and Piety. Welcome, AJ.
Very strange place for a Jew to be. Good evening. Thank you so much for coming. One wonders with such talks and such weather if maybe just my students who had to be here would be here. For my students who have to be here, you are responsible for this material. For the rest, we're responsible as well. What we're doing this evening is very difficult material, so I feel that I should give you trigger warnings. We will be talking about difficult issues like rape and domestic abuse and abortion, but this is stuff that needs to be discussed. In January of last year, the dean sent me an email that read, "Next year is the 20th anniversary of the Carpenter Program in Religion, Gender, and Sexuality. Ellen Armour, and her staff would like to plan a celebratory program of events around the 2016 Antoinette Brown Lecture. They have asked me to invite you, as the founding director of the Carpenter Program, to give that lecture. They seek to honor your careful shepherding of the program through its inaugural 10-plus years and believe that your scholarship on the relationship between Christian and Jewish traditions, parenthesis, as well as on gender and sexuality, parenthesis, position you to provide particularly rich reflections on issues facing women in ministry, the purview of the Antoinette Brown Lecture. So I immediately wrote back to express my gratitude to the dean for the honor, and I also wrote in the same email, I do not think my work in gender and sexuality is parenthetical. With 13 volumes of the Feminist Companion to the New Testament and Christian Writings, my current and now published work on the International Bible and Women Project, numerous articles on women, gender, and sexuality, and over 100 church, synagogue, and clergy programs on those topics, I think my work in gender and sexuality is as primary as my work in Jewish-Christian relations. So how did these fit together? Today we hear frequently the term intersectionality. This is the buzz term for this spring. The term was coined by Kimberly Crenshaw, a black feminist academic, in 1989. Intersectionality addresses the intertwining of forms of oppression, racism, sexism, ableism, classism, homophobia, transphobia, colonialism, and so on. And intersectionality also requires attention to one's privileges of race, of class, of sexual identity, and so on. Yet the discourse on intersectionality, and this is about as theoretical as I'm going to get, so just bear with me. The discourse on intersectionality usually ignores the particular manifestations of privilege that occur in divinity schools and indeed in American culture, and that's Christian privilege. Likewise, in the standard list of social evils, anti-Semitism and anti-Judaism typically go missing. So, some folks regard anti-Semitism and anti-Judaism as having been ended by the Vatican document Nostra Aetate, published 50 years ago last October, which asserts that Jews at all times and places cannot be held responsible for the death of Jesus. Fabulous. However, and you know, it's good to know, anti-Jewish sermons still continue in Catholic as well as Protestant and Orthodox and Anglican pulpits. The Association of Theological Schools, the major U.S. accrediting organization for divinity schools and seminaries, rejected my petition a few years ago that they have all member schools provide targeted instruction to Masters of Divinity candidates on how to avoid anti-Jewish teaching and preaching. And the fact is, such instruction is not required here at Vanderbilt either. And so prejudice continues to flow from the pulpit to the pew. And when clergy are not trained how to speak about New Testament texts that castigate Jews, prejudice is inculcated with the reading of the Bible on Sunday morning. Or perhaps it is that anti-Semitism and anti-Judaism are regarded as non-issues, given the supposition that all Jews are white and that we're rich and we run the government. You know, we should be so lucky. The first point is false, as numerous African, Asian, and Latin American Jews embody. Moreover, for the rest of us Jews, we only code white when it's convenient for the majority culture to do so. Or as Daniel Boyarin once put it, Jews are white, but not quite. We're not all rich, we're not all powerful, and the sad thing is I have to make this point since even some of my students are unaware of it. Prejudice continues. So I know what it's like, because I'm a Jew, not to be given a job, precisely for that reason. I know what it's like, because I'm a Jew, to be steered away from buying a home. I know what it's like to have my children called dirty Jews and told that they are going to hell because they don't worship Jesus. And I know what it's like in my own synagogue to worship under police protection, lest some lunatic thinks that by killing Jews, he is fighting for Palestinian autonomy or white supremacy or against the people who control the banks and the media. But I'm also my mother's daughter. My mother was told by her parents that her education was less important than that of her brothers, and whatever money they had was dedicated to sending the brothers to medical school. And because she was a Jew, my mother in the 1930s could not be hired as a teacher in the public school system in New Bedford, Massachusetts. My mother, widowed early, found that without a husband, traversing the economic world was difficult and sometimes humiliating. So I learned from my mother how to navigate in a male world. And I learned from my teachers and friends at Smith College, a women's college, how to network. And I learned from Elizabeth Clark, my mentor at Duke University, how to develop a women's studies program. I learned from my colleagues at Swarthmore College, where I taught before coming to Vanderbilt, how to thrive as the only tenure-track woman in my field at a school where then there was no maternity leave and no stopping of the tenure clock for pregnancy, and if you had a baby, you best did so between mid-May and mid-August. And I learned from my splendid husband, with his splendid timing, among other wonderful things, that not only women are feminists. So I know what forms of discrimination look like, and I can't sit still when I see them. This may be an addiction. I have neither the talents, nor the knowledge, nor the time to speak across all systems. But where and when I can, I speak, or I write, or I march. My work in Jewish Christian relations, like my work in gender sexuality, my work in prisons, my work for Americans for Peace Now, which is dedicated to a two-state resolution in the Middle East, it's all based on the same principles. And related as well was my work as chair several years ago of the Vanderbilt University Faculty Senate, where we shepherded through same-sex partner benefits. These basic principles should be clear, and they are intersectional. When one person suffers, the human community suffers. There are no innocent bystanders. We are all responsible for each other. Silence kills, and so does ignorance. So, the areas in which I focus concern the Bible in its various canons. So if the state does make the Bible the state Bible, I gotta worry about whose. From before I chaired the Carpenter Program to this day, I have been receiving calls, emails, and letters related to such deployment of the Bible as a weapon, because the Bible can be a very dangerous book. Here are 10 examples of the typical calls that come in. My child is gay, is he going to hell, and what can I do to save him? By the way, I am this coming Wednesday speaking at Belmont University on the Bible and homosexuality. You're welcome to come. 2, my child was abused by a church elder, but my pastor told me I could not call the police because, as Paul states in 1 Corinthians, when any of you have a grievance against one another, do you dare to take it to a court before the unrighteous instead of taking it before the saints? The same argument, by the way, is used in Orthodox Judaism, who speak of the sin of Metzira, of turning over a community member to the Gentile court. 3, I had an abortion, am I damned? 4, every time I pray Our Father, I think of my father sexually abusing me, I can't pray, help me. I'm alienated from the church, 5, its father and son and male priesthood, where is the image of the divine or of authority that looks like me? 6, I'm queer identified and my parents just threw me out of the house because they said I was contrary to nature and an abomination. Where do I go? 7, my spouse beats me, but I can't divorce him because Jesus said, anyone who divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery, and whoever marries a woman divorced from her husband commits adultery. What do I do? 8, my ex-wife won't let me see the kids because after we divorced, I moved in with the man I love, and she calls this expression of love sinful. I actually served a couple of years ago as an expert witness in family court in a child custody case based precisely on that scenario. 9, I feel called to ministry, but my mother keeps citing 1 Timothy 2. Let a woman learn in silence with full submission. I permit no woman to teach or to have authority over a man. She is to keep silent. For Adam was formed first and then Eve, and Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. And 10, how can I love my body, let alone love another, when my church has taught me to associate sex with shame? And this is all from bad Bible readings. While the Bible has been deployed as a weapon to create or sustain such issues, it should also be seen as the source of, well, intelligent instruction and amazing grace. It has the potential to harm, but it also has the potential to heal. So we turn to the specifics of where the carpenter, that's an allusion to Jesus, and the program, as it develops, intersects with policy and piety. I will start with 3 quick examples of what the Bible teaches regarding rape, adultery, and sexual response. And then we'll turn to 3 places, among others, where in part because of biblical interpretation, people are dying. Condemnations of homosexuality in general and gay marriage in particular, abortion, and domestic abuse. And I'll turn finally to a quick notice of women in the Bible to show our power and authority. And in all cases, I seek to further conversation, not to foreclose it. So we start with rape. The Bible tells us that rape happens, Jacob's daughter Dinah in Genesis 34, probably but not conclusively a rape, the gang rape of the Levite's concubine in Judges 19, and the rape of Tamar, David's daughter, by her brother, the crown prince. There's also the near rape of men who visit Lot in Sodom, and the near rape of Lot's daughters, whom he just offered to the mob. So what do we learn from this? Well, we learn that rape happens, and not just to them over there, and not just by them over there, but to us and by us. We learn that the rapist, along with the victim, is a human being, a person, also in the image and likeness of God. And I know this in part from working at Riverbend, where I work with men convicted of rape, because they are more than their crimes, and they too are in the image and likeness of God, and heaven forbid we judge people by the worst that they've ever done. We learned that escalation of violence is not a preventative. We learned that the victim needs to be given a voice or the time to remain silent. We learned that blaming the victim is wrong. We learned that there's no quick fix or one-size-fits-all response or even any clear response, but that communication must continue. Dina's story in Genesis ends with her brother's question, should our sister be treated like a whore? The answer is obviously no, but how one responds to that question requires thought, and it requires compassion, and it requires listening. The Bible opens the conversation, and the text waits for priests and rabbis and pastors to address rape from the pulpit. Because if rape is addressed from the pulpit, victims will come forward, and then healing can begin. And the Bible talks about adultery. It happens. From Reuben and Bilhah to David and Bathsheba to the unnamed woman brought to Jesus in John chapter 8. That's the scene where Jesus advises, let the one who is among you without sin, let that person cast the first stone. Those people there, by the way, are not carrying stones. The scene is set in the temple. The dropping the stones, that's just Hollywood. Right? They're not about to execute her. So what do we learn? We learn that although adultery is listed as a capital crime, no one in the Bible is stoned for adultery. And so we learn that our initial impulses, kill the unfaithful, provides no long-term resolution. The Bible, in recounting these stories, does not provide all the circumstances or the motives for the adultery, and therefore it tells us that we are not in a position to judge. Did Bathsheba seduce David while he was watching her, or was she watching him? Did David rape Bathsheba? What happened to the man who committed adultery with the woman brought to Jesus? Was she raped or seduced or coerced? Or was that, she thought, her one chance for happiness? Jesus doesn't forgive the woman he encounters. That's not his call. Forgiveness, if it is to be granted, must come from her husband. Jesus rather tells the woman that he does not condemn her. And that may be our best move on the outside. Do not condemn, do not judge, do not demonize, because you don't have all the information. And for a final example of resources, and this one a happier one, the Bible, on the other hand, sometimes literally, tells us that women's sexual pleasure is normal. In fact, women's sexual pleasure is terrific. Biblical women, in other words, don't need to lie back and think of Israel. So. Now, why mention this topic along with rape and adultery? Because all three cases are avoided in religious settings and they need to be addressed. As Peggy Ornstein put it in the March 19th New York Times Sunday Review, quote, statistics on sexual assault may have forced a national dialogue on consent, but honest conversations between adults and teenagers about ethics, respect, decision-making, sensuality, reciprocity, relationship building, the ability to assert desires and set limits remain rare. And while we are more often telling children that both parties must agree unequivocally to a sexual encounter, we still tend to avoid the biggest taboo of all, women's capacity for and entitlement to sexual pleasure. The Bible does not avoid the question, although I rarely hear this preached on. Two examples. Overhearing that she and her elderly husband, Abraham, will have a child, the postmenopausal Sarah laughs, of course, and says to herself, now that I am old and my husband is old, am I to have pleasure? The Hebrew word for pleasure is edna. It's a cognate of Eden. and Sarah is talking about the pleasure of sexual intimacy, and good for her. The verse, by the way, is Genesis 18:12. You can remember that because of Tchaikovsky's 18:12 overture, because for Sarah, the cannons will go off again. And then there's Song of Songs, also called Song of Solomon or Canticles, which celebrates physical love. Just three verses here. Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for your love is better than wine. While the king was on his couch, my nard gave forth its fragrance. My fingers with liquid myrrh upon the handle of the bolt. Nard, myrrh, and bolt are all metaphors, and we'll leave it at that. For rape or adultery or sexual response. The Bible is not really an answer book. It's a book that helps us adduce the important topics, and it helps us ask the right questions. And it's a book that is often cited in the intersection of piety and politics. So here are three more issues, all of which are part of today's national discourse: same-sex marriage, abortion, and domestic abuse. Well, there's more. There's always more. But these are among the issues of gender sexuality in the Bible that require immediate attention because lives are at stake as gay people are attacked, as women die from unsafe abortions, and as domestic abuse across the globe continues. Same-sex marriage. Locally in September, State Senator May Beavers of Mount Juliet and Representative Mark Pody of Lebanon proposed the Tennessee Natural Marriage Defense Act, which proclaimed that in this state, marriage is between one man and one woman, regardless of any court decision to the contrary. The bill was defeated on January 20th of this year. According to Ted Cruz's website, which I accessed on Easter Sunday, it's what Jews do on Easter, marriage is a sacrament between one man and one woman. It has strengthened societies for millennia, and we must uphold the truth of marriage. So we'll ignore here the fact that polygamy has existed for millennia and still does in some cultures. And in fact, it's prominent in the Bible where King Solomon, known for his wisdom, had 700 wives and 300 concubines, and that's really more than you need. So what prompts this crusade, and I use that term, I think, appropriately, against same-sex marriage is, in fact, the Bible, although folks won't admit it. You have to go back to the Defense of Marriage Act of 1996. The Defense of Marriage Act, by the way, was signed into law by Bill Clinton. It was declared unconstitutional by the Supreme Court in 2013. That's the idea that marriage has to be between one man and one woman. What we're seeing today is the heirs of that act. The Southern Baptist Convention, in support of the Defense of Marriage Act, insisted, redefining the concept and legality of marriage to mean anything other than the union between one man and one woman would fundamentally undermine the historic and biblical foundation of a healthy society. And then, God bless them, they cited the Bible. This is always good, because whenever you cite the Bible, you can come up with alternative readings. They cited Genesis 1:28, Genesis 2:24, and Matthew 19:4-6. So I, the Bible scholar, thought, let's look up to see what the verses say. Genesis chapter 1, verse 28 states, God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living thing that moves on the earth. A few things to note. The verse has nothing to do with marriage, nor does it condemn infertile couples or couples who adopt. Indeed, the commandment was already fulfilled, so it's not our responsibility. The commandment about being fruitful and multiplying was fulfilled following the Tower of Babel debacle in Genesis 11:19, where we read, therefore it was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth, and from there the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of the earth. They'd done it already. It was done in Genesis 11. We don't have to keep up. It is a misreading of the Bible, I think, to insist that everyone must procreate, and given overpopulation, a closer reading of Genesis proves helpful. We've spread over the earth already. We don't need to take up every inch. By the way, it is equally a misreading to take dominion over the earth as an excuse to destroy our natural resources and ruin our environment. Our role is rather one of stewardship. God made it, it's good, and we're supposed to protect it, not trash it. Genesis chapter 2, verse 24 states, following the creation of the woman out of the man, you remember this story? From that from which the woman was created was probably not a rib, but probably his penis bone, which is technically called a baculum. Baculum is Latin for penis bone. It's also Latin for crozier or bishop's staff. One might appreciate the irony of the terminology. Therefore, a man leaves his father and mother and clings to his wife, and they become one flesh. So that's the marriage verse. The verse, first of all, has nothing to do really with sexuality and not necessarily anything to do with marriage. Clinging or cleaving, the Hebrew term is davak, the modern Hebrew equivalent means glue, is exactly what the Moabite Ruth does with her mother-in-law, the Israelite Naomi. As Ruth puts it, Naomi, Ruth clung to her. 1:14. Ruth leaves the home of her father and her mother and goes with Naomi to Bethlehem, where they form a new family unit. To cleave, to stick to a person, is to make a new family unit, not to have intercourse. If it meant to have intercourse, then all married people here who cleave to their spouses, I know there are a few of you, you would be having intercourse right now. That would be interesting. It would also be distracting. It simply means you're forming a new family unit. In Eden, the family unit is a man and a woman. On the outskirts of Moab, it's two women who are widows. And finally, in Matthew 19, 4 through 6, here's what we read. Jesus answered, "Have you not read that the one who made them at the beginning made them male and female and said, 'Therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh?' So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." The problem here is that the Southern Baptist Convention doesn't quote the verse that comes right before, and whenever you lift a verse out of context, things go a little weird. The verse before reads, "Some Pharisees came to Jesus to test him, and they asked him, 'Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any cause?' The issue isn't gay marriage, it's divorce. Jews knew that divorce was permitted because the book of Deuteronomy permitted. The question was, under what circumstances? Was it a no-fault system, or did you actually have to engage in some form of betrayal of the spouse? Jews also debated how much of the woman's financial investment into the marriage and contribution to the marriage could she receive back, since all Jewish women at the time had a prenup called a ketubah, a marriage contract, giving the woman financial support in case of divorce. So here's what happens. After quoting Genesis chapter 2, verse 24, Jesus goes on to forbid divorce. But divorce is sometimes necessary when abuse occurs, or when love has died, or perhaps when a spouse is permanently incapacitated and the surviving spouse needs companionship, love. Perhaps such issues will be addressed in Pope Francis's widely anticipated document, Amoris Laetitia. The English translation reads, "On Love and the Family," but the Latin actually means "the joy of love," and this will come out on April 8th. What's really behind all these arguments on same-sex marriage are the biblical statements that appear to forbid homosexuality. And I say appear because we're not really sure what those statements mean. And since I'm going to develop that subject at Belmont, I'll simply note here that the same chapters in the Bible the SBC evokes can actually be used to support same-sex marriage. And I take the support from the Jesus playbook, because Jesus really was a fabulous reader of scripture. Back to Matthew 19, two verses later in 19, 7 through 8, Jesus is asked, "Why then did Moses command us to give a certificate of divorce and to divorce her?" And Jesus said to them, "It was because you were so hard-hearted, because of your hardness of heart, that Moses allowed you to divorce your wives, but from the beginning it was not so." That is, Genesis, from the beginning, trumps Deuteronomy. You have two texts that seem to be in opposition. Figure out which one is more important. I think the same point holds for same-sex marriage. In Genesis chapter 1, God creates the world, and it's fabulous. And the refrain is repeated as in 1:31, God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. But suddenly in Genesis 2, something is not good. In Genesis 2:18, the Lord God said, "It is not good that human beings should be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner. If God says it is not good for a human being to be alone, then it is equally not good to condemn gay people to lives of singleness and celibacy. As with divorce, Genesis here trumps the law code. Concluding thoughts on same-sex relations, and then we move on. Close to when I first joined the Vanderbilt Divinity faculty 21 years ago, I spoke up in a faculty meeting about why I thought we needed to do more across the Divinity curriculum to address queer issues. A faculty member then went to Joe Huff, some of you will remember him, the dean at the time, to ask him to censure me for using the term queer, which said faculty member took to be an insult. He had no clue about the number of sessions at the Society of Biblical Literature or the American Academy of Religion devoted to queer theory and queer biblical readings and queer ethics and so on, which means at least here at Vanderbilt, we've made some progress. We have the technical terminology and we have the theory. We need more action. We must speak out, all of us, regardless of our subject positions, when we see bigotry. And we must support those who, because of who they are, risk censure or worse. The woman whose nana doesn't understand her coming out. The same-sex partners whose parents can't support their lifelong commitments. Gay siblings who risk being told by sisters and brothers, "I still love you, but I'm worried you're going to go to hell." Transgendered parents whose children reject them. Fighting the good fight may leave us wounded, it may kill us. But that's in fact what today, part of what taking up the cross means. And so abortion and related issues, including access to birth control, accurate sex education, and services provided by Planned Parenthood like pap smears and VD testing. Like same-sex marriage, wombs are another trigger in current political debate. Efforts to defund Planned Parenthood, despite the proof that the tapes of selling baby parts were faked, speaks to the import of the problem. On the other hand, last month, in the publication of the 2017 national budget, we learned that President Obama is seeking to remove all federal funding for abstinence education. This may be a good move, since the $2 billion, spent over the past three decades on abstinence education has not proven terribly effective. Abstinence-only education programs do not delay initiation of sexual activity. They don't reduce teen pregnancy. And frankly, we're not doing much better broadly in sexual education. Recently, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention stated, fewer than half of US high schools and only a fifth of middle schools teach all 16 components the agency recommends as essential to sex education. Only 23 states mandate sex ed at all, and of these, only 13 require it to be medically accurate. Memphis leads the nation in sexually transmitted infections. Then again, Tennessee is one of those 37 states that don't require sex ed curricula be deemed accurate by medical or sexual health organizations. So who knows what they're learning? But without sex education, there will be more venereal disease and more unwanted pregnancies, and more unwanted pregnancies means more abortions. Parents aren't providing the information, and in some cases, parents don't know it. Is it the job of the schools? Or perhaps it might actually be the job of religious institutions where we can talk about sexuality and ethics and morality, and it's okay. Here, the Methodists got it right. The United Methodist Book of Discipline, in its social principles, 161.2f, the nurturing community, states, the church should support the family in providing age-appropriate education regarding sexuality to children, youth, and adults. Surely the conversation needs to be had, or we'll be seeing more STDs, more unwanted pregnancies, and more abortions. So we turn to abortion. The Bible is inevitably part of the conversation. Pro-life proponents argue that the Bible shows the fetus to be a living soul. Psalm 139, God, it was you who formed me in my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. Isaiah 44, thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, who formed you in the womb. I am the Lord who made all things. In the opening verses of Jeremiah, then the word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you came forth out of the womb, I sanctified you. And in the New Testament, the prenatal John the Baptist leaps inside his mother when she hears the voice of the Virgin Mary. So he's clearly clued into Christology. For many, thou shalt not kill includes the killing of an unborn child. These are all very good arguments. Pro-choice people, if they are informed about the Bible, will suggest that the Bible finds that life begins not at conception, but with breath. Genesis 2:7. Then the Lord God formed the human from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the human became a living being. Or they'll cite Exodus 21. When men strive together and hurt a woman with child so that she miscarries, and yet no harm follows, the one who hurt her shall be fined. But if any harm follows, then you shall give a life for a life and an eye for an eye. In other words, the fetus, if it dies, monetary compensation. The woman, if she dies, an eye for an eye. So is the Bible clear on abortion? In an article published in the Evangelical Theology Society Journal, Meredith G. Klein writes, "The most significant thing about abortion legislation in biblical law is that there is none. It was so unthinkable that an Israelite woman should desire an abortion that there was no need to mention this offense in the criminal code. I cannot imagine a society where no woman ever thought, I don't think I should have an abortion." Absence of evidence is not evidence of absence, and there may be no law against it because they knew they could not legislate. To be clear, my point is not to argue either for or against abortion rights. There are good arguments on both sides. It's rather to show that the Bible can be adduced on both sides of the issue. It doesn't mean that either side is reading incorrectly. It does mean that we always have to determine what to emphasize and what to ignore. It also means we can't stop with the Bible. The Catholic Church forbids abortion. The Jewish tradition allows it under certain circumstances. This is a quote from the Mishnah. If a woman labors to give birth and it is feared she may die, one may sever the fetus from her womb and extract it member by member, for her life takes precedence over that of the fetus. Who lives, who dies, and whose religion trumps the other? To forbid abortion politically would be to trample the religious rights of Jews. To allow it would offend the teachings of the Catholic Church. So in these cases, the first step is make sure you do not demonize the person on the other side of the table, because they are also in the image and likeness of God. And then we look not only to the Bible and to theology, but to science. For example, we do not, in fact, know when life begins. Fertilization, implanting, gastrulation, when EEG waves appear, birth. And we do not know what is best for each pregnant woman, and to make that decision for her is to infantilize her. So we must talk. And what finally does the Bible teach us about medical procedures, including those Planned Parenthood provides? It tells us that the human body is in the image and likeness of the divine, so it has to be cared for, and that includes health care. And health care includes sex education, and health care includes making sure that there are no back alley abortions. And care of the body finally brings us to the topic of domestic abuse, a subject I've addressed for local workshops and for the Gibord Center in Los Angeles, and here a special shout out to Marie Fortune for her leadership in the Faith Trust Institute. The U.S. Department of Justice lists five categories of domestic violence: physical, sexual, emotional, economic, and psychological. In March 2013, Attorney General Eric Holder, in announcing the, quote, Domestic Violence Homicide Prevention Initiative, presented the following statistics. On average, three women are murdered every day in this country by a boyfriend, husband, or ex-husband. Experts estimate that for every victim of domestic violence who is killed, an additional nine nearly lose their lives. And many others, including children, coworkers, neighbors, and police officers, are injured or killed while trying to stop violent acts or simply because they're in the wrong place at the wrong time. In September of 2014, Attorney General Holder announced a $2.6 million grant for domestic violence homicide protection. That's nice. Now, I note that the F-35 Lightning II military plane costs $200 million per plane. And then there's the $2 billion on abstinence, but $2.6 million on domestic violence is a start. Domestic abuse is a global problem. The extent to which religion in general and the Bible in particular is complicit is a matter of debate. We do not have good data on the numbers of men who use the Bible as an excuse to abuse their wives, or for that matter, parents to abuse their children. Nor do we have good data on the number of women who remain in abusive relationships because well-meaning pastors or friends or relatives tell them that through their silent suffering, they are doing God's will. And we do not know how many wives remain in abusive relationships because they read in the New Testament that Jesus forbids divorce. Yet even if one person is suffering because of some misplaced notion of biblical warrant, then we all have work to do. And the problem is that rabbis, pastors, and priests often fail to use the Bible as the basis from which to speak out about domestic abuse and rape and incest. Why? Because some think the congregations want happy, feel-good messages or something about those folks elsewhere whom we might help. No reason to disturb the choir. But if coming to church is simply to allow us to feel good about ourselves, something has gone wrong. Alas, many feminist theologians remove the Bible from being able to help as well. Some feminists dismiss the Bible as hopelessly patriarchal and so do not mine it for resources Jewish and Christian women in abusive situations need. Telling religious women to dismiss the Bible or just tear out the pages is not a viable option. That move tramples another person's religious identity, and it's the type of privilege intersectionality should warn us about. The privilege of the academic, the informed, the conscientiotized, who has no use for the Bible or the church. That privilege speaks to its own choir. And many well-meaning folks, including feminists, indeed mostly white, economically secure feminists, have blamed the victim. She should have left home or divorced or found another church or drove to a shelter, got a new apartment, whatever. But not all women have enough self-confidence to read the Bible on their own, and not all women want to leave their church or their marriage, and not all women have the economic resources to leave their husbands. They don't know where to go. They don't have a car to get them there, and the shelters are full, or they're worried that their children will be taken from them. So let's look at two texts usually read to sanction abuse and see what they say. Ephesians 5:22-24 exhorts, "Wives, submit yourselves to your husbands as unto the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject to Christ, so let wives be to their own husbands in everything." Based on these verses, some women are taught that they must obey their husband, and if they don't obey, they should be disciplined. Indeed, there's a relatively new literary genre known as Christian domestic discipline. For those who liked 50 Shades of Grey or the beauty books, this is the variation. The Christian wife is spanked for her own good, the husband acts as Christ in meting out the discipline, and everybody's happy. I don't make this up. The first epistle of Peter offers an even stronger teaching. Wives, in the same way as slaves obey their masters, accept your husband's authority, so that even if the husband is not a Christian, he may be won over without a word by your conduct. And based on that verse, some Christian women are counseled not to report abusive behavior or even to talk about it. They're to suffer in silence in hopes that their gracious submission will move their husbands' hearts. There are several ways of approaching these texts. Here's what's not helpful. It's not helpful to tell victims that Paul probably didn't write Ephesians and Peter probably didn't write 1 Peter. It's in the Bible. It also does not help to tell conservative Christian wives who submit to their husbands that they're stupid, benighted, ignorant, or foolish. Telling them they're foolish is no more helpful or culturally sensitive or correct than telling Muslim women who choose to take the veil or Orthodox Jewish women who choose to cover their heads that they are victims of a patriarchal system. The issue here has to be choice. Some women find Christian submission, again, voluntary, to be emotionally and spiritually satisfying, and the submission typically works pretty well when the husband is also a committed Christian who takes seriously the New Testament exhortations to husbands. Choosing to obey, however, is not the same thing as choosing to be battered in any of the forms listed. So here are three notices that might help prevent abusive understandings. First, we see that wifely obedience is part of a larger genre, the household codes, in which the hierarchy of the household is described. Ephesians goes on to instruct slaves, be obedient to them that are your masters according to the flesh with fear and trembling as you are to Christ. 1 Peter exhorts slaves, accept the authority of your masters with all deference, not only those who are kind and gentle, but also those who are harsh. For it is a credit to you, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. We should find such comments about slavery reprehensible. We do not tell victims of human trafficking, oh, just be obedient to the person who sold you. To demand that wives be obedient, but to find reprehensible the same demand made of slaves, is an inconsistent and usually hypocritical reading of the text. Second, we can attend to the historical context in which the codes were written, because the context helps us determine what biblical material holds good for all times and what is culturally specific. For Christian wives in the first century married to pagans, disobedience could endanger the church. Some Romans found Christianity dangerous. Believers were refusing to worship Roman gods, and to refuse to worship the city's gods was a form of treason. Obey your husbands, because if you don't, we'll be accused of treason, and it will be bad for everyone. There was a reason in antiquity to exhort Christian wives to be obedient. Today, the danger of being a Christian in most parts of the world is not related to wifely obedience, but there is, by the way, a danger in being a Christian. In North Korea, Saudi Arabia, Afghanistan, Iraq, Somalia, and Egypt, and on this Easter Sunday, Christians were targeted by bombings in Lahore, Pakistan. And we remember them. But allowing oneself to be abused is not going to help anyone. Today, rather, by remaining silent, abused women can put the church in danger because once that abuse is known, their silence gives the impression that their churches condoned the violence. Must speak up. Further, as Paul makes clear in 1 Corinthians, do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God, and that you are not your own? To abuse the body, or to let it be abused, or to let anybody else's body be abused, is to abuse the temple of the Holy Spirit. And third, along with exhortations to wives, there are exhortations to husbands. Paul teaches, for the wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does, and likewise, the husband does not have authority over his body, but the wife does. Ephesians begins its household code with a call to mutual submission. Submitting yourselves to one another in fear of God. And it continues, husbands, love your wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Husbands should love their wives as they do their own bodies. Each of you men should love his wife as himself, and the wife should respect the husband. So husbands must treat their wives with Christ-like love, and if the husband is not behaving in a Christ-like manner, the wife has grounds for complaint. So what finally then? To encourage women to speak up, does the Bible tell us about women in particular, that being the subject of Antoinette Brown's concerns? We have numerous splendid examples, and if we knew more about these examples, we'd be more likely to fight against abuse. Women in the Bible are not merely property. They're prophets, from Miriam and Huldah to Anna and the temple, the women in the Corinthian churches and Philip's daughters. They're teachers, from the wise women of Abel, Beth, Maacah, and Tekoa to Tobit's grandmother to Priscilla, the wife of Achaia. They are judges and military leaders. They're homeowners and patrons, Martha, Dorcas, the mother of John Mark, Lydia, the women who run house churches. They have access to their own funds. The great woman of Shunem who supports Elisha, the women who, according to Luke, fund Jesus' mission. They're apostles and deacons, and Jewish women in the New Testament are not following Jesus because they were oppressed and suppressed and repressed or depressed by Judaism. They followed Jesus because they found his proclamation of the kingdom of heaven compelling, as substantially do I. The biblical text is, finally, patriarchal and androcentric. It is not egalitarian. It is not gender-free, but that is no reason for presuming that inequality is either God-given or natural or to be enforced. On the subject of religion, gender, and sexuality, there are no easy answers, but there are decisions we have to make. Here, the Bible, more than a book that helps us ask the right questions, we are our brothers and sisters' keepers, so that care for the victim and care for the perpetrator both are our responsibility. These are, in fact, the intersections that we must build or traverse or reinforce. And once we have these ideas in place, once we can have the conversation and then move from theory to action based in compassion and love, then the Bible really can be what it's supposed to be, a rock on which we stand rather than a rock thrown to do damage. Thank you.
We have about 10 minutes for questions, and let me remind you what a question is. It has that funny little thing at the end, and it doesn't go on for a long time. Any questions for us tonight?
Are you all okay? Alba.
Hey, Dr. Levine.
Nice to see you again.
Nice to see you too. I would love it if you could speak to us a little bit about those of us, our neighbor state, those of us in North Carolina who have just been through HB2 against bathrooms and transgender folks. And I would love to hear your thoughts specifically around the ways in which particularly the religious right has been using the Bible as a weapon that leads to the violence against our trans siblings.
Yeah, thank you very much for the question. The Bible's always going to be deployed in any sort of political discourse. The question is, on the one hand, why is it that on gender sexuality issues, it's the religious right that deploys it and the left simply punts? As if for people on more liberal ends of things, the Bible is either unusable or they're afraid of entering church-state problems, or they simply don't know what they're doing. It seems to me that the Bible is always going to be used in political discourse. I'm a big favor of using the Bible in political discourse. This is liberation theology. So yes, use it in political discourse, particularly if it's mine, right? So what do you do? I find one-to-one conversation helpful. I find bringing a human face to issues helpful so that we argue not in the abstract, but we argue in the personal. I find looking at other verses and not shouting people down by proof texting, but saying, here's how I read the text, would you read it with me? And this requires a fair amount of effort for people, say, on your side of the table, actually to go to Pastor so-and-so or Reverend so-and-so and say, I want to work with you. Our goals are the same. We want health and wholeness for everybody. Can we work this out more broadly? Or how are your particular rights being trampled given my way of expressing love? I also find it helpful in working on alternative biblical readings. So when somebody says, as I demonstrated this evening, the Southern Baptist Convention says, here are the go-to verses, look up those verses and see what they actually say, and look up some other verses that might provide a counter, and those are there. It has to be done peacefully. It has to be done with respect for the person across the table, because the vast majority of folks who will disagree with you politically are not bigots, and they're not troglodytes, and they're not stupid. They're trying to read the Bible as faithfully as possible, and that needs to be respected. So it's really hard, but can you do it? Absolutely. And you can always email me, as you've done before, and you can do again. Yeah. Yeah, and I do. I respond to all of them. And in a number of cases, I invite people to come to my office. And in some cases, I meet them across the street at Starbucks or at Panera. In some cases, they come to my home. Sometimes it's easy because I know exactly what they're looking for and I can provide them a resource. You want to know where a shelter is? I'll tell you. And I'll tell you how to get in touch with police or social workers or people in churches. When I first got tapped to lead this program, I thought it would be helpful to know a little bit more about what was then called pastoral care and counseling and is now called practical theology, because I figured it would be the therapists and the psychologists that were on the front lines. So I called Vine Street Christian Church, Middle Tennessee's Pastoral Care and Counseling Center, and asked if I could sit in on the staff. Counselor, but I can suggest to different people, here's the person you need to see, and so-and-so works on a sliding scale. Here's a book that may be helpful to you. So again, there's never any one-size-fits-all model. It's trying to listen as closely as possible to the person on the other end of the phone or to read through that email what needs to be said. And sometimes the very fact that I respond means that voice is not, pardon the cliche, a voice in the wilderness, and that person's concerns are legitimate concerns, and that's sometimes what they want. When it comes to the elder is abusing my kid in the church, and what am I supposed to do? I just proof text. Better that a millstone be put around that guy's neck and he be thrown into the sea. Your job is to take this case to court. And in contemporary courts, you're not swearing by pagan gods, you're swearing on a Bible. I think you'll be okay. Right? So sometimes it's direct, and sometimes it's just a listening ear, and sometimes it's a referral to a person or a space or a book, and sometimes it's the beginning of a lifelong friendship. But one must respond, and thank God we've got a divinity school where people know that they could call the switchboard and the calls can come up to me and to some fellow faculty. That's what we do. That's what you do if you've got education.
Hi, Dr. Levine. As a child of a Christian and a Muslim, how can we be prepared to deal with the fact that they're not super compatible in the way that the thought is? Because my dad's from Afghanistan, for example. Mm-hmm. Obviously, it's a fairly repressive country. How can we take our Western experience of talking out and dealing with issues that are just swept under the rug?
Yeah, thank you. It's a wonderful question. I will not willingly speak about Islam because I can't read Arabic, and I'm very hesitant to speak formally about a tradition where I can't read the primary sources. I think that's a little dangerous for all of us. You're a living example of what one does, and it may be that you, rather than somebody fully on the outside, is in the best position to do this because you can straddle both worlds and you can function in both. I'm not a big fan of imposing somebody's values on somebody else. I don't want certain groups in Afghanistan to impose their values on me, and I think they might not want me to impose my values on them. But I would start with who's getting hurt. I would start with education. Among others, some of the columns from Nicholas Kristof in the New York Times speak about the importance of education, particularly women's education, as moving things along. I would put pressure on any U.S. government which is supporting regimes that are not doing enough to help people, particularly women, to make sure that they pay attention to where our money is going. And that means any of us can write to members of Congress or members of the Senate. Person by person, village by village, book by book, woman by woman. As with everything, there's no quick fix, and there may not be a fix at all. There's an old rabbinic line. There's no rabbinic line for everything. But there's an old rabbinic line that says, it is not your duty to complete the task, neither are you free to desist from it. You've asked the right question. You'll have to determine your own answer.
Thank you, Amy Jill, for your faithful service to the Carpenter Program for all these years, for the years that you were the director, and for your continued passion and work. And we are all better for it. My question is this. You have a unique relationship with folks in prison. some of the perpetrators that you mentioned. What work should we be doing? What should we be offering? What is helpful for those who find themselves in the end of being that part of the justice system?
Yeah. Thanks very much, Yvonne, for asking that. I actually went out to death row this afternoon, and they wouldn't let me in because there's a new security protocol. So after half an hour, David Philippi and I just left. I'll go back next week. What we do depends upon who the we is. What we do at Vanderbilt Divinity School is we take our students out there, and we read texts, and we do theology, and we study history with people who have been in prison for 30 or 40 years, and we recognize that whatever we thought was right is incomplete, and whatever stereotypes we have are wrong. And we see people guilty of murder, rape, child molestation, as also in the image and likeness of God with backstories and futures. We engage in relationship with them because people ought not to be storehoused. And for some of these folks, they have no family. Their families let them go as soon as they were convicted. And they have no friends, and they have no sense of respect. We take them seriously at their word. I had one student my very first year there who was not a particularly good writer, but he had wonderful ideas. And he said to me about 6 weeks in, he said, because I've been responding to his papers, he said, "You think I'm smart." And I said, pardon this expression, "You can't write for shit, but you're smart." One's vocabulary decreases a bit at Riverbend. And he said it was the first time in his life that somebody told him he was smart and didn't want anything from him. Not drugs, not cars, not power, not money. Recognize them as human beings. Help them when they're on parole. Provide them a job, because it's really hard to get a job if you've been convicted of a felony and you have a 40-year lag in your work history. Provide them guidance and stability, as in halfway homes. Provide them social skills, because after 40 years in prison, it's very, very easy to mouth off to somebody or to strike out and not to be able to take an insult and roll with it. It's a lifetime commitment, but that's something surely houses of worship can do. And what do you do in the church? If it's a child molester, you make sure that he or she is always accompanied by two other people. But they're also members of what the church would call the body of Christ, or the synagogue would call the community of Israel. Don't let them go, and remember them in your prayers.
I'm going to pick up on what he said. One person at a time is a good thing. But at the administrative level, could you foresee a time or perceive a way to bring in advisors at a theological level just to explain nuances of differences in religion? We certainly need it in the media, but we've got secretaries of everything but theology, and just understanding the nuances for the sake of the conversation.
We actually have people in the government who work formally in interreligious conversation. Rabbi David Saperstein has just been appointed to that position. So we do have people in the government who do that. Our problem is that we who are in theological education are usually just monolingual. We can speak Christian, right? We can speak Muslim. We usually can't speak across the divide. And in order to have those conversations more fully, it helps if we were actually bilingual. Vanderbilt Divinity School requires its Masters of Divinity candidates to take courses in interreligious conversation. But a single course in Islam is not a conversation, it's a course in Islam. So what we need to do is do something a little bit more proactive in saying, how do you talk across those divides? What do you hold firm and what is negotiable? How do you have a conversation, an interreligious dialogue, without sacrificing the particulars of your own tradition on the altar of interfaith sensitivity, because it's not really about singing Kumbaya? Right? How do you stand firm for who you are? And too often, we in America have no clue who we are, because we don't know that much about our own traditions, let alone about somebody else's. But could this be done? Absolutely. Would it help for anybody to have better cultural critique? And cultural critique also includes religious critique, so that even when we're talking about globalization, it's not just the global church, it's the global everybody. But that's harder.
Last question.
I know many Shriners, good friends. They do great, great work wherever they are. They voted not to allow gay people in their organization. I haven't seen any response. I hesitated because my church hasn't been that outstanding in that regard either. But no other religious leader, or should there be members of the Vanderbilt Divinity School who would respond in a very positive way. I was just disappointed no one has done it. Mm-hmm. And I haven't had the courage, or I would say the fact that I'm not that proud of my church's teaching on that, especially, you know, in recent past.
Thank you, Father Breen. I'm a member of an Orthodox synagogue. Our track record isn't that great either. I believe it's the Masons, not the Shriners. There have been some letters, including letters to the editor, that have been published in the Tennessean, and there are a few more letters online condemning this recent vote. Should this be the job of Vanderbilt Divinity School as a school? No. I think not, because there are certain people on our faculty, including members of the Catholic Church, who would agree with the idea that same-sex relations are sinful, and I don't want to speak on behalf of everybody else and trample their rights. But darling, if you want to sit down with me tomorrow morning and draft out a letter, I'll co-sign it with you, and I'd be happy to send it in. We pick our battles carefully, right? Pick your battles carefully. The Masons or the state legislature? The Masons or your church or your synagogue? We can't be all things to all people. Paul tried and it was a dreadful failure. We have to figure out what battles need to be fought. This may be one, and perhaps people who are related to Masons, children of Masons, folks who are personally invested, perhaps the front line should be their call rather than people stepping in from the outside. But darling, once again, I love you. Anything you want to do, you just call me. Crook your little finger and I'm there. And on that happy note, thank you very much.
I think you really like her.
AJ, as you know, our tradition is that the lecturer gets a memory from us in the form of a framed poster, and it is with great delight that I give you this one.